morning, New Hampshire Democrats. Good morning, everyone. It is great to be here with you on this fantastic day, and I'm humbled to stand before you as one of your representatives in Congress. You know, I want to thank my friend Governor Lynch for that introduction. Isn't Governor Lynch amazing? He is the anti-Trump. He is humble. He is compassionate. He is a people person. And he's also a successful businessman. We could use more like him. Of course, we're all excited to have the next president of the United States in the House today. And boy, do we ever have a critical role to play, New Hampshire, not just in winnowing this field down, but in shaping the terms of our national debate well beyond February. And you know what? We're going to show the rest of the country what unity looks like once the dust settles from this contest. So it's an honor to share the stage and share the delegation with my wonderful colleagues, Gene Shaheen, Maggie Hassan, and Annie Custer. I thank them for their service to the Granite State and for standing up for our shared values on a daily basis. Thank you as well to our great state party, Chairman Buckley, and the staff of the NHDP for putting together this unprecedented event to bring us all together here today and to set us up for great victories in 2020. And to all of you delegates and guests, welcome to the great city of Manchester. We are proud of our city, and we are proud of our great Mayor Joyce Craig, who we're going to re-elect in November. So folks, I can tell you this. After 8 months on the job, my time in Congress has at times been frustrating, and it's at times been exhilarating. I entered Congress during the longest government shutdown in American history, when 800,000 federal workers were being used as political pawns by this president because he couldn't get Congress to fund his wall, or Mexico for that matter either. That was frustrating. But I also entered Congress with an incredible dynamic group of majority makers, the youngest and most diverse freshman class in U.S. history. That is exhilarating. And so at this unprecedented moment, when we have a president who is estranged from the truth, who is risking our credibility on the world stage, who is dividing Americans along old fault lines, and who is undermining our fundamental ability to get some things done, our House majority is determined to find a way forward. And we're demanding priorities on issues that have long languished in Washington, D.C. So in the House, we passed the first increase in the minimum wage in more than 10 years because working people deserve a raise. We passed the DREAM Act because dreamers among us deserve to have a pathway to citizenship. They're part of our family. We passed legislation to put the United States back in the Paris Climate Agreement where we belong, not leaving our chair empty on the world stage. We passed legislation to protect the ACA and protections for individuals with pre-existing conditions against relentless Republican efforts to gut them. We passed the Equality Act because it's long past the time to guarantee equal rights for the LGBTQ community in every corner of this nation. We passed H.R. 1, the For the People Act, that gets big money out of our political system and Citizens United and reins in the big corporations and special interests that have too much power in Washington, D.C. And 6 months ago, we passed universal background checks because it's long past the time to realize action on the American tragedy of gun violence. And by the way, we're returning to Congress next week, and we've got to get the assault weapons ban passed as well. So, of course, on so many of these critical measures, they wait on Mitch McConnell's desk. They see an action in the Senate. McConnell fashions himself as the grim reaper of the United States Senate. Imagine wearing that as a badge of honor. He thinks it's all about politics, all about preserving the power of the special interests, regardless of the sentiments of the American people. Well, that may play well in Moscow, but not here in Manchester. And if he can't hear us today, you know, he doesn't like that. But look, if he couldn't hear that today, he's going to hear us when we elect Jean Shaheen and a Democratic Senate next fall. So folks, democracy is not a one-and-done affair. One election can only change so much. It can't change everything. It's our sustained effort, our sustained level of activism and engagement that determines our long-term success. I grew up in a family restaurant business just up the road. I learned everything I know about the world around me from that experience. I learned that every day is an all-hands-on-deck kind of day. I learned that no job should be too big or too small for any member of the team. And I learned to be of use. And that's what this era calls for. That's why so many folks stepped up to run for office in 2018 who might not otherwise have thought about it. And that's why all of you are here today, because our democracy requires us to be of use. So folks, we've got to keep working. We've got to keep our eye on the ball, because in the chaos of the Trump era, we can't lose sight of what's at stake or fundamentally who we are. This nation is much more kind, more decent, more generous, more big-hearted, more forward-thinking than what Donald Trump represents. We don't live in Donald Trump's America. This nation belongs to all of us, and it's up to us to stand up and reclaim it. So let's work hard. Let's stand up. Let's stand strong. Let's stand together, shoulder to shoulder, in 2020, and make sure that we elect Democrats up and down the ticket. Let's get to it. Thank you all so much.